So first, in the context of the, so thanks for the this opportunity to present the work that was done by many different sites, many different groups. And with Florence Bourgeois, today we'll be showing you these considerations that are specific for the pediatric studies. Where, in the context of COVID-19, something to take into account is that the clinical presentation of COVID-19 differs substantially between the children and youth and the adults, where there's a unique clinical features, complication and outcomes in those kids, where there's, as you all know, a very low prevalence, which is good, but makes it much more difficult to study. And as you know, there's already a very low inclusion in children in the context of clinical trials. So to be able to study what's going on, it's really important to be able to have those observational studies, which are to be able to study the trajectory of those patients. So the first, within the pediatric group, we have published two papers working on the third one. And the first one, which is as Griffin and Tiongxi presented on a phase one study, look at the aggregate counts across the various sites, where we have included 671 children and youth that were admitted for COVID-19 with a PCR test positive across 27 hospitals and 6 countries. So this is the international analysis of EHR across the COVID-19, the 4CE consortium, where we have sites from North America, Europe, and Asia that participated. And those 27 hospitals were grouped by different aggregators, what we called the sites. And what's really interesting is the fact that based on the IRB, the Institutional Review Board, that approved the study at each of the different institutions, we have seen a learning experience from the IRB within this study, where in order to be able to participate, where as presented, no patient level data was shared across outside of the institution, only aggregate counts. But then based on the level of aggregate count, what was the obfuscation threshold? What was the smallest number of patients for a specific feature that was allowed to leave the institution? As you can see here, each institution negotiate with its own IRB a different threshold. For example, where Bordeaux, there's no threshold, but in Paris, there's less than 3 threshold for anonymization. So that's why those numbers are very different, because it's a different negotiation. What we've seen within this paper is how for half of the sites, this threshold went down, because they were showing this table to their IRBs and explaining how within this pediatric study, we needed to have a low threshold to be able to see outcomes. And they agreed, so as a learning experience, to be able to decrease this obfuscation threshold. For example, MGB, Mass General Brigham, for the adults, the threshold is less than 10. At the beginning, it was less than 10. And then Sean managed showing this table to the IRB to go to less than 3, which was definitely useful. So there has been a real learning shared experience across the different sites. Now, looking at the results, with the number of new hospitalized pediatric patients per day in the 4CE hospitals, that's the panel A, across the different countries, compared, so with across the various months in 2020, from the beginning of the pandemic to end of October, and compared with the panel B with the national country range. So you can see that there's the y-axis is obviously different, because here you have the full country versus the hospitals that were participating. But even with only a few hospitals, we were able to see the trend of the first wave of the pandemic that was following the trend from the adults. And so very interestingly, to be able to see across all the different countries. Then looking at the clinical characteristics, the complication of the proportion of patients during the hospitalization, where we had 15% of cardiac arrhythmia, 13% of viral pneumonia, 10% of respiratory failure. So that we're able to track and follow. And looking at the lab results, where as it was shown within the adult population, we also showed that the inflammatory markers as CRP, ferritin, and procalcitonin were higher at the admission. But because of this consortium, we just had something more interesting than just admission. We were able to do the follow-up and looking at 14 days since the admission, looking how those inflammatory markers were first increasing and then decreasing during the admission, with the D-dimer that went up after 6 days within for as a coagulopathy within the hospitalization. Well, and compared, which is different with the adults, where we didn't see any increase of the white blood cell count in the pediatric population. And to finish, looking at the medication use, as you all know, in the pediatric population, there's the known off-label systematic use of approved drug for adults that are used for children. And what we were really interested to do is to look at what were the medication used in these children and youth for different drug class. The repurposed agent, for example, aminoquinoline, like hydroxychloroquine, and looking at the number of healthcare sites treating with at least 3 patients. So we had to do this because of the obfuscation counts across some of the sites. And we could see that there were 7 patients that were treated in US with hydroxychloroquine, and also looking for investigation agent like remdesivir in UK, but also more adjunctive therapies. So all this at the end enable us to be able to explore this low prevalence population of affected COVID to be able to explore exactly what was going on to be able to further studies. And so all the data that I've shown is publicly available for download, aggregate per country on the covidclinical.site website. And now I'll pass it to Florence for the next papers and work.
Thank you, Paul. Hello, everyone. My name is Florence Bourgeois. I am a pediatrician by training, and I've had the pleasure of being a part of the 4CE group from early on. And in particular, as Paul alluded to, the pediatric aspects of the COVID pandemic have evolved in very different ways from the adult population. There have been fortunately fewer cases, also lower morbidity, and also different phenotypes. And all of these factors have required different approaches and strategies. And what's been most remarkable about 4CE is that despite the scale of the network, we've been able to adapt our approaches to address those very specific considerations and at times challenges. I'm going to go through 2 additional brief studies just to provide some flavor for some of the work we've been able to do specific to pediatric considerations. So the first was one to look at the trends in COVID-19 cases nationally, with an eye towards augmenting the data we had available through 4CE to better quantify and compare national disease burden and trends in hospitalizations in kids versus adults. And then the second strategy is a demonstration of how we've expanded the 4CE capacities to also look at indirect impacts of COVID, in particular among kids. And this study is focused around some of the mental health conditions that we've seen emerge in adolescent patients. Next slide, please. So this first study was led by Megan Hutch out of Northwestern University, and it was entitled National Trends in Disease Activity for COVID-19 Among Children in the US. Keep in mind that especially early on, it wasn't clear what the role was of kids. With influenza, we've historically been concerned, for example, about kids being the vectors for transmission. So with COVID-19, it wasn't clear if they were also the harbors of some of the greatest disease activity or whether the disease manifestations were sort of working in parallel with adults. Next slide, please. So we used here healthy US data from the HHS, so Human Health Services. It's national data, it's fairly comprehensive, making it a very nice data source to look at overall hospitalizations nationally. In the green line, you're looking at hospitalizations per 100,000 adults, and the orange line is hospitalizations per 100,000 children. Keep in mind that the scale is tenfold less for children. What we're showing here is that kids have much lower disease activity compared to adults, again, with a tenfold difference in scales. And notably also, if you look at the asterisk indicates where there's a significant change point in terms of trends or upward tick in this case. And you can see that they're fairly well aligned. So activity in kids does not precede activity in adults, which was very important, especially early on in determining what exactly the role was of kids in a pandemic, in the disease transmission. Next slide, please. Also worth noting is that the US is quite heterogeneous. And we've noted several times along the way that the waves in surges and also in mitigation have varied across the country. Here we used four fairly crude geographic groupings, but still you can see that the surges have different levels and they occur at different rates. This is true not just for the adults, but also for children. Again, if you look at the small asterisks for the Midwest, Northeast and West, those are significant change points and kids do not, or fairly, I think they preceded the adults by about a week, but they are not significantly different from adults in terms of the timing for these surges. Again, indicating that overall their trends are following those of adults, though the peaks are much lower. Next slide, please. So our main takeaways here was really some of this information, how can it inform and guide future 4CE studies? So as we mentioned, peaks in COVID-19 hospitalization rates were about 20-fold less for kids compared to adults, though the temporal trends were fairly similar. Second point was that there's substantial variation across regions. So this is something we need to take into consideration as we sample populations from not a comprehensive pool of hospitals within 4CE. And thirdly, the finding highlights really the importance of dedicated analyses of pediatric COVID-19 data, since the trends are different from adults in terms of the peak surges, in order to measure impact of the pandemic on kids, in order to appropriately assess public health measures, and also to anticipate pediatric healthcare resource needs.
Florence, you have 2 minutes.
Thank you. I will talk very quickly. So some of the indirect impacts of COVID-19 on children. While the direct impact, as we've mentioned, the morbidity has been much lower compared to adults, what we saw over the course of the year as pediatricians is that there are numerous stressors in adolescents related to some of the mitigation strategies. So school closures, disruptions of routines, et cetera. And in pediatric institutions in particular, we've seen a substantial increase in anxiety and mood disorders among kids. So we took a look at our resources within the 4CE multinational network to see how we might be able to quantify and evaluate those indirect impacts. Next slide, please. So a few pertinent protocol modifications that we were able to do in a fairly agile fashion. We required a pre-pandemic comparative period, so we quickly extended our time period for the study. We required non-COVID hospitalizations. So this study was not limited to patients who are COVID PCR positive. We were only focused on a subset of 4CE hospitals. So those that were pediatric hospitals that admitted patients to their psychiatric units. And then we decided to just focus on adolescents who appear to be bearing the brunt of some of these mental health conditions. Next slide. This is a quick sort of illustration of the type of study we designed. We were interested in looking at temporal trends in admissions to the hospitals related to mental health conditions. And our final analysis will be an interrupted time series analysis. Next slide. Our participating institutions are 4 in the US. And what's particularly interesting about this study is that we're also including a number of pediatric hospitals in France. So our hypothesis is that this is not a US specific phenomenon. And we have 3 hospitals in the APHP network in Paris and also Bordeaux University Hospital in France participating. Next slide. This is just some very early preliminary look at what this looks like. We're looking at, in gray, pre-pandemic rates of psychiatric admissions, and then in orange, during the pandemic period, rates of hospitalizations. And what's most striking here is that we're looking at a US hospital and a hospital in France. Next slide. So more to come on that study as we're just finalizing it. And in terms of our next phases, we're looking at ways to leverage the 4CE network to examine new disease phenotypes related to emerging variants, to do a deeper dive into multi-system inflammatory syndrome in children. There's still a number of unanswered questions and also significant challenges in terms of varying definitions and how we can validate those using EHR data. And of course, post-acute sequelae in pediatrics, still very poorly defined, including some of the specific long-term complications. And one particular consideration in around this question is how do we differentiate some of the sequelae or complications that we're seeing, whether they're related to COVID-19 or some of the treatments that were administered. Thank you very much. This is the last slide, and happy offline to both Paul and myself to talk to anyone interested in any of the pediatric work in 4CE.
And thanks to all the different sites